Neither side wants nuclear annihilation. But one has to ask, what is the US and Iran's endgame? Americans are wary of another quagmire like Afghanistan and Iraq. And Iran's military might hasn't been put into full force since the 1980s. A war between these two countries would see a staggering loss of life. And the economic impact? Well, neither Washington nor Tehran can afford to waste billions of dollars right now. But here we are, with Donald Trump issuing and then cancelling strikes on Iran, and Hassan Rouhani calling the White House idiotic, all after a recent US request for talks was followed up with sanctions against Iran's supreme leader. Well, let's get straight into the debate with our panel of guests. In Los Angeles is Iranian activist Roxanne Ganji. Her father served as Iran's Minister of Education under the last Shah before his ouster in 1979. From Washington, we're joined by Mary Kaszynski. She's the Deputy Director of Policy at Ploughshares Fund, an organization committed to denuclearization. And in Tehran is Setareh Sadeqi. She is an American Studies PhD student at the University of Tehran. Good to have you all on the program. Roxanne, let me start with you. Do you support the new sanctions?
Yes, I definitely do. I think it was long overdue, and I totally support it. I'm totally against war. I think the sanctions were long overdue since the 2009 Green Movement. If the Obama administration had supported back then the grassroots movement of the people of Iran, I think this regime would have not been in place today, and we wouldn't be talking about sanctions. But unfortunately, they decided during the Obama administration not to stand with the people of Iran and their movement, and instead send them $57 billion, which they've spent on their proxies and on spreading terrorism. So I totally support these sanctions.
Roxanne, the argument from the Obama administration and those who supported the nuclear deal was that it brought in Iran from the cold, it allowed for engagement, and it also would help prevent Iran from ever getting a nuclear weapon. Now the new sanctions are saying, well, we need sanctions because we want to stop Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. But that verifiable deal that Iran wasn't cheating on was already doing that. Do you understand why it seems a little paradoxical from the Trump administration?
Okay. I do understand this point of view, but it's not just the issue of the nuclear issue for the people of Iran. For the past 40 years, the Iranian people have been not looked at. They've been overlooked by the international community. The human rights abuses that go on in Iran every day. I mean, the world knows about this. Okay. Iran is a number one state sponsor of terrorism, state of terrorism. So, I mean, the people of Iran are done with this regime in its totality.
Understood.
So it doesn't matter if there are going to be nuclear issues. These people are sick and tired of being terrorized by a regime that's holding them hostage.
Roxanne,
for the past 40 years.
Do you believe that the sanctions don't hurt the people?
I have a talk show on Channel 1 TV here in Los Angeles, and I'm in constant contact with a lot of the youth in Iran. I can't say a majority of the youth, but I can get a good vibe. The people of Iran are willing to go through a hardship period if they know that it's going to be the downfall of this regime.
Setareh, are you willing to go through hardship if it means the downfall of your government, according to what Roxanne said? The sanctions might pinch and might hurt, but it's worth it. That's what she said. What do you think?
Of course not. And I don't think it's, I mean, it's absolutely against human rights. And I don't see how someone with Iranian backgrounds can support sanctions on Iranian people, because they think putting pressure on Iranians and making them go through hardship would finally give them some chance of what regime change or whatever the hawkish B team is pursuing in Iran. And it's like double detrimental for the people, even if, which I do not agree with that, but even if this current government in Iran is not what you favor or what Iranian people support, you are actually putting pressure on Iranian people, and it's like they are being pressured from both sides. Mm-hmm. This is not the way to support a people who, even if they were, like the majority, were against the government, which I don't think is true, this is not the way to support opposition in one country. sanctions directly affect Iranian people. It has made them their lives difficult, and it does not, it has not for 40 years changed anything about the Iranian government. It has only made them stronger. Iran has learned its ways to evade sanctions or to develop capabilities within its borders.
Okay.
So how are you going to justify escalated tensions and pressures against Iranian ordinary citizens?
Okay, and it's good to get that perspective from a young Iranian in Tehran. Mary Kaczynski, so Trump said he didn't want to kill 150 Iranians unless it was absolutely necessary. The good news, I guess, is that there was no strike. On the other hand, there are sanctions, signed, sealed, directed at the leadership, and other sanctions that undoubtedly affect the people. Is it worth it, Mary?
It's absolutely not worth it. I think it's really important when we're looking at the results of sanctions to consider the evidence. And the fact is that the sanctions that the Trump administration is imposing on Iran are hurting ordinary Iranians. We hear everyday stories from Iran about food shortages, medical shortages, children who can't get medicine because of what the Trump administration is doing. These sanctions have also failed to change the behavior of the regime. President Trump violated the nuclear deal over a year ago, reimposed nuclear sanctions, even though Iran was complying with the nuclear deal, and then piled on a lot of other sanctions. What we're seeing now is Iran is actually taking steps away from the nuclear deal. So those sanctions, not only were they a violation of that bargain and U.S. obligations under the deal, those sanctions were counterproductive. Iran is now taking more dangerous steps as a result of these sanctions. Now, to be very clear, if the Trump administration had focused on sanctions for human rights abusers or support for terrorism, there would be a lot of support for those sanctions. I think all of us would support those kind of sanctions. But because Trump has so unreasonably imposed nuclear sanctions and done it without the support of the international community, it's hurting Iranians, ordinary Iranians, and empowering the Iranian regime.
Roxanne Ganji, Nasrullah Pejmanfar, who's a member of the Iranian parliament, had something to say just after the news of the sanctions, and I'll paraphrase it, it's quite a big quote. He said the Americans placed a huge hat in our heads once with the JCPOA, the nuclear deal, got many benefits from us. They took us to the negotiating table to gain benefits from the start. And then he goes on to say, well, they played us. We will never negotiate with them again. We're hearing this a lot from Iranian politicians. Is that what you want? This clear binary and this clear division between the Americans and the Iranians, which invariably might lead to conflict?
Okay, let me first address Setareh. I think if your journalists go on the streets of Iran and talk to the people, you will, and I'm sure you follow, there's plenty of YouTube tapes available of how disenchanted the people are with this regime, and they want regime change. So that you guys can't cover that up anymore.
I live in Iran.
I mean,
I don't,
we get it
YouTube
on a daily basis. Second of all, the sanctions don't include medicine nor food. So that part is it's not because of the sanctions, and I don't think that's very true. Second of all, the government of Iran has held your people, our people, hostage for 40 years. If somebody wants to be admitted to the hospital, they have to go and get their own medicine before being admitted. They have to pay up front. So, I mean, it's not like the Iranian government was a bed of roses and has provided you guys with everything. You know, the human rights abuses on a daily, they have the highest number of prisoners in the political prison. There's on the streets of Tehran every day, women are being attacked because of the hijab. And now lately, it's even been worse. We see it every day. So it's not like we're dealing with, everybody's playing the Islamic Republic as, this is not the people of Iran. It's the Islamic Republic is not the victim here. The Islamic Republic is the culprit here. For 40 years, it's been doing this to the people. We had a senseless war with Iraq. No Iranian wants a war. The only way that, and if you think that they're going to come to the negotiating table, Khamenei has said over and over again that he's not going to sit with the Americans.
Okay. Okay.
And he's the supreme leader, and he's the big
honcho that
decides.
Roxanne, so to that point, It's interesting that Khamenei was added to the sanctions. Now, the man hasn't traveled for 30 years. And fascinatingly enough, Trump...
But the man has a lot of money abroad.
Well Trump, interestingly, I mean, Trump actually said, and maybe this is, it might have been a slip of the tongue, or it might be revealing as to his level of education on the subject. He actually said Ayatollah Khomeini is being sanctioned. Now, I mean, unless he really... He's sanctioning him because he doesn't want him to come back from the dead. I'm assuming he meant Khamenei. I'm assuming he meant Khamenei. But again, here's my point, Roxanne. Why do you need to go to that level? Here's a man who hasn't traveled for 30 years, right? You're showing the Iranian government that you're directly targeting them and their most dear symbols. You think that's not going to lead to war?
What do you mean their most dear symbol? You mean Khamenei is the most dear symbol? I don't think on the streets of Tehran, except for a minority, that Khamenei is the symbol for their revolution. I mean, seriously, please follow what's going on in Iran.
You have no problem
people
with
of Iran targeting. Have had it with the
There's no practical
Republic.
Benefit
Khamenei
to targeting Khamenei. Here's the point. There's no practical benefit. If sanctions are the U.S. Treasury sitting down saying we want to choke the Iranians from using money to do bad things, Khamenei, you would accept there's no practical benefit to sanctioning him. So it's symbolic. So why would you do that unless you were itching for a fight, Roxanne?
Well, actually, I think who's itching for the fight is the Islamic Republic. And they've shown that very directly in the Strait of Hormuz. And they're not going to stop.
Okay.
They
okay,
did this again in the Iran-Iraq war, but this time the people of Iran won't stand for a war.
Okay, good
and
point.
Nobody, including myself, no patriotic Iranian wants a war. It doesn't solve anything.
Got it.
The thing that will solve this is to stand with the grassroots movement of the people of Iran and support the Iranians. And keep in mind, the territorial integrity of Iran is number one for all of us and our sovereignty.
Let me ask Setareh, hold on, Roxanne, let me ask Setareh. So isn't there a fair point to be made here when we look at Iran in the region? And again, I don't want to treat you as somebody who's a representative of the government or a spokesperson of the government. But might the Iranian government be jeopardizing the lives of its own people by what it does in the region, by what it did allegedly in the Straits of Hormuz, what it does by supporting the Houthis in Yemen, what it does by supporting Bashar al-Assad in Syria, what it does in destabilizing Lebanon and Iraq, and so on? That's a part of the conflict that Iran has with the West, because they look at its behavior and you have a bunch of countries saying we need to do something about this. Do you accept that?
What does the U.S. has to do with the region? Why should the U.S. has its troops everywhere in the region and target ordinary citizens and ally itself with the most brutal violators of human rights, for example, in Saudi Arabia Emirates.
But Iran, the U.S. supports Saudi Arabia and the Saudis do terrible things. Undoubtedly, check. How about the Iranians support Bashar al-Assad, responsible for half a million people dying, and people want to do something about that? Do you accept that? Mm-hmm.
The question should be, what would the region be like if the U.S. was not involved? This is the logical questions to ask. Like you said, I'm an Iranian citizen. I do not necessarily support every decision that my country or the governments of my country is making, and I'm not a spokesperson for them. I do not approve of any violation of human rights anywhere in the world, but this is very hypocritical that the U.S. claims that they are putting pressure on Iran because of violation of human rights, but at the same time, Pompeo meets with Saudi kings and princes and it does not bring about the brutal murder of its Washington Post journalists.
Right. Okay.
So this is very hypocritical.
Okay.
And
find it hypocritical.
I mean, Iranian people and people of the world are not going to believe that they are the U.S. is really concerned about human rights or even terrorism.
Okay.
They have been supporting terrorists in the region for so many years.
Okay.
And by the way, I want to add this, that how can you be patriarchal and support violation of the rights of your people? This is, I find it very
Trump style. The rights of my people have been taken away
style.
By your government for 40 years.
Okay. She
and
wants
if you're
regime
telling
change.
Me the U.S. should not be in the region, what is Iran doing all over the Middle East?
Okay.
What are we doing building hospitals
in
places in
Iran. Well, I'm not surprised. You haven't traveled to Iran probably for 40 years.
Why are we spending money on the proxies instead of spending
on the poor
people?
Roxanne, I'm talking from Tehran. When was the last time you were in Tehran?
Okay, listen.
I'm a young Iranian.
Roxanne and Setareh, just a second. I want to bring Mary in very finally because I'm out of time. Okay. Mary, from the Trump administration's perspective, it's not very predictable what Trump will do. We've seen people like General Joseph Dunford, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, asking for things to calm down a little bit. We see people like John Bolton being bullish and hawkish and saying, let's go and get him, right? Which side is winning right now, in your opinion?
Right now, I think John Bolton and the Iran hawks, the people who want a war, they're winning. And that's because President Trump has been wildly inconsistent. He's creating conditions for war. One day he says, we're going to do military strikes. The next day he says, it's only sanctions. And the day after that, it's, I want talks with Iran. That's not a strategy. That doesn't lead to a long-term solution. That creates chaos. It creates the potential for conflict. On the other hand, you have John Bolton and others within the administration and within the U.S. who are advocating for military strikes against Iran. And to be very clear, there's no such thing as a precision strike. There's no such thing as sort of a short bombing campaign and then we get out. That's an attack on another country. Bombing another country is an act of war. And while John Bolton is in the White House and Trump is in the White House, that situation becomes more and more dangerous over time. It's very likely that we're going to see a military conflict within the next year and a half if cooler heads don't prevail on both sides.
Okay. Mary, Roxanne, and Setareh, I hope to have you all back on the program sometime soon. But I've got to wrap for now. I thank you very much.
Thank you.